Consider all the works thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art! Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees, mountain grander, and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior.
Let's turn to hymn number 241, Jesus, the Very Thought of Thee. Hymn number 241.
Jesus, the very thought of Thee, with sweetness can frame, nor can the bear.
Next, let's turn to hymn number 326, Open My Eyes That I May See. Hymn number 326.
Glimpses of truth thou hast for me. Place in my heart the wonderful key that shall unclasp and set me free. Silently now I wait for thee. Ready, my God, I will to see. Open my eyes, illumine me. Speak. Of truth thou sendest clear, and while the wind notes fall on my ear, everything false will disappear. Silently now I wait for thee. Ready, my God, I will to see. Open my ears, illumine me. The warm truth everywhere. Open my heart and let me prepare love with thy children thus to share. Silently now I wait for thee. Ready, my God, I will to see. Open my heart, illumine me.
Turn to hymn number 482, Father, Lead Me Day by Day. Hymn number 482. To hymn number 517, My Faith Looks Up to Thee. Hymn number 517.
Hear me one.
Mark is here. We're good. Thank you.
Thank you for that song service. Appreciate that. I see a lot of Pathfinders in their dress uniforms, and that makes my heart feel good, knowing that it's Pathfinder Day here in Chula Vista, so we're looking forward to that. So I want to welcome each one of you here this morning. I want to welcome those who are watching online. I hope you had a good week this past week and that you felt the presence of God with you day by day. And I just wanted to remind you of our 13th Sabbath offering. So we just have two Sabbaths from today, that'll be our 13th Sabbath offering. And, just remind you, God puts it in your heart to give a generous offering. I've never seen, if you look at the back of your quarterly, it lists all the projects, and it's in very small type. I need reading glasses to see it anymore. But I've never seen so many projects. It's a very ambitious undertaking that they have this quarter. So please give as you are able towards these projects. And at this time, I'll ask Carlos to come forward with our prayer and scripture. Thank you.
For our scripture reading, please turn to Psalms 145, verse 5. I will meditate on your majestic, glorious splendor and your wonderful miracles.
Please bow your heads for prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for letting me, my sister, and my dad come up for scripture and prayer. Please let us have the Holy Spirit in our hearts. And for Pathfinders, let us not be nervous. And you give us the braveness. And just help us today and every day of our lives. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen.
I'd like to say a prayer. Generous. I'd also like to say a prayer. Bow our heads with me, dear Lord, Heavenly Father, thank you for another Sabbath, dear Lord. Thank you for being in your house, dear Lord. Thank you for being here in your sanctuary, dear Lord. Thank you for just being in communion with you today, dear Lord. It's a special day. Today is Pathfinder Day, and we give thanks to all the work you've done and all the strength and courage you've given the Pathfinders before us, dear Lord, to have paved the way for us, dear Lord. And we're so grateful, me and my family personally, dear Lord. We're grateful for the program, and it has done wondrous miracles because of you, dear Lord. Amen. Dear Lord, just want to take time and pray for my brother Fritz, heal him, dear Lord, whatever he, difficulties going through, be with him. And we pray for a soon recovery for him. Anybody that's dealing with any kind of sickness, dear Lord. And just want to say, just put a hedge of protection over our youth, dear Lord. our pathfinders, our adventurers, and just give them strength and courage throughout the day today, especially so they could have a good time and praise you and glorify you, dear Lord. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you so much for that scripture and prayer, God bless you as a father, Carlos, and all of our parents raising young people. It's never easy raising children, but especially now, there are so many things that, you know, the devil can use to try to take our young people away. So let's continue to keep our young people and our parents in prayer. And keeping with the theme of Pathfinder Day, I invited, and I didn't realize, Aldie, how many responsibilities you have today already, or maybe I wouldn't have asked you this, but thank you so much for accepting. But our Pathfinders had their Kite Day recently, and I noticed it was, you know, a little bit, the weather was, I wasn't sure if it was going to rain or not, but it looks like that the weather held up, and it seems like it's always windy over there, so hopefully the wind was good and you guys had a great time. So looking forward to hearing your report about Kite Day.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. I was blessed, inspired by the prayers of our Pathfinder and Carlos. It is indeed a privilege to serve for the Lord. From the lowest and highest capacity, when we represent His name, just like what Carlos had mentioned, miracles do happen. Hearts are being converted, and souls are being dedicated for God. What a privilege it is to serve to our Pathfinder Club here in Chula Vista, who has been in existence since 1952, at least that's what we claim. But that's how far we could trace it. And we have done so many things to bring our kids to the foot of the cross. That's our goal. That is our goal through our own local club programs, conference participation, and county coordination the same. So how do we do that? We certainly continue our Tuesday meetings. We're here from 6:30 to 8:30, and that's an opportunity to mingle, to interface, to minister to our children through our Pathfinder classwork and Bible study. That is an ongoing event that is happening. A blessing for that is if one Pathfinder approach you and share with you how their day is, that indeed is a true blessing. Because sometimes our youth, our younger generation are reserved. They don't open up readily, especially to adults. And to engage with them every Tuesday is such a wonderful blessing. So what are the things that we are being busy with the previous quarter and this quarter? Well, the North American division is upon us. It's upon us in a few months, in a few weeks, in a few days, we could say that, I guess. And we have been preparing a lot for this trip. We praise the Lord for Uncle Frank and Uncle Efren for repairing our Pathfinder vehicle. Of course, for Mr. Rapp and Brother Gary Williams for sharing their knowledge and experience about road trips. Because we are so excited when we get there, we will be meeting more than 65,000 people. 65,000 children of God, 65,000, more than 65,000 Pathfinders, not only from North American Division, but from all over the world, characterized by different types of uniform, different type of marches, different types of patches, different type of pins, but the common denominator is same servant of God, the same and only servant of Jesus. What is a great denominator. And thereby, this first quarter, we are so focused as well, not only on equipping our children, but also using those skills that develop in order to support funding our trip, one of which was held in January. We thank you so much for supporting our fundraiser for car wash. It is very much well attended. For some of our young people, this is the first time they have to wash a car. And at least it's good for them to know what are the external parts of a car, what makes a car run, what are the things in a car that they need to be careful of, how important brake is, how important to check your tires. But beyond that, it taught them how to humble themselves in service to the Lord. We praise God for our adults who are very patiently providing, teaching, guiding, mentoring our young pathfinders. They learn how to vacuum, to clean, to dry cars. And most importantly, we share the gospel every time there's an opportunity. This is Levi and his dad. During our car wash, we also put a station for reading materials. So we have books there, Great Controversy, Desire of Ages, Glow Tracks. And we put that right where the chairs for waiting customers are located. And we have one person who is talking to our guests and supporters. And at the time we were visited by Furbin's parents, it was Levi that was there standing next to them. Very excited to see his grandma and grandpa right there to support the Pathfinder car wash. And yet beyond them blessing our Pathfinders with funds to support our cause, the greater cause is for Pathfinders to share and witness for them. So I took that opportunity the same to stand with Levi and Furbin next to their parents, to their grandparents, and talk to them about their background, the kind of work that they do. And they mentioned about church and what we do. And I grabbed that opportunity to represent who we are, especially the Sabbath. And we ended up our conversation with a word of prayer. And I could sense the emotion and blessings felt by the couple. What a great opportunity, not only to share that time together, but most importantly, to share the word of God. Pathfinder care cards. So in the month of February, adventurers and Pathfinders joined forces to make cards. And these cards are from RAW. We use papers, stickers, drawing, and inside that card are Bible verses or words of encouragement. God loves you. John 3:16. God cares for you. Have faith in the Lord. The Lord will strengthen you. The Lord is good. God is love. So these are the things that our Pathfinders had written with their own hands. Now, what are these care cards for? Well, we need to reach not only outreach, but we have to also inreach. And who are they? We have some elderlies that can no longer come to church for one reason or another. May it be transportation limitation, may it be physical restrictions, may it be because of ailment or illness that they have, or because they are in a facility. These are the target demographics of the Pathfinder care cards. We were surprised because we received a text of thanksgiving from Pastor Rudy Carrillo, a retired pastor and the former Pathfinder director for Southeastern California Conference. And that text message is a thanksgiving for Pathfinders for remembering him with his care cards. A great ministry that our Pathfinders had done as well for the month of February. Pathfinders is about discipline. Pathfinders is about classes. Pathfinders is about Bible study and relationship with Jesus. And because of that, we are following curriculum that is established by the North American Division funneled to the conference, to county coordinators, and then its club. And to validate every participation, performance, organization, deployment of curriculum by its club, there is an annual Pathfinder club inspection. So this inspection is where our county coordinators would come, and they would express check the effectiveness of us deploying our program. So there are some requirements in terms of organization, in terms of flag raising, marching, Pathfinder pledge and law, Pathfinder song, how we articulate to the children Bible studies and the classes that they have. And for every area, sections of the curriculum, there are corresponding points. And each club, for every inspection that is held, has to make 100 points. We are a new club, and we know that we will not score high. We know that from the get-go. In fact, if I would suggest to you, our club is so new that there was no former Pathfinder that came back this year. Because of the pandemic, all of them are past high school. And so we have brand new Pathfinder club. And yet, we told them, this is not about points. It is about your love for Jesus. Because if you love Jesus, it will manifest on how you stand on your attention and your discipline to be patient and be still. If you love Jesus, you will pay attention to instructions and listen to command, right face, and you will do that. If you love Jesus, it will be very easy for you to understand the curriculum, the gospel, the Bible study, your own personal devotions. And so they came. Brother Tony and Sister Williams are our assistant county coordinators for South San Diego County. They came, and they were surprised, and they were in awe of what they have seen. And out of 100 attainable points, our new Pathfinder Club here in Chula Vista earned 98 points. We have only given 2 points. You see, miracles, Brother Carlos, miracles. We knew that we will not score high points, and yet in God's grace, we are able to be blessed. Such a great witnessing by God to our young Pathfinders, that when you seek God in prayer, He would bless you. He indeed would bless you. And of course, the highlight of this report, as Brother Mark had alluded, is our Kite Day. Kite Day is very special in Chula Vista. We may not be as good in marching, but when it comes to kites, we have a master kite builder right here. And we certainly were blessed to have our master builder, and we can certainly make our own kite that flies. We do make our own kite. We don't buy our kite pre-made. They are purchased from raw materials, rolls of material similar to the material used for tents. So they are durable. And so our kids would be there to attend the workshop. They're there learning how to put them together, sewing them together, and of course to fly them. This picture is the Sunday before the Kite Day, and we decided to have a family Pathfinder picnic at J Street Marina, where they were able to fly the kite that they made the very first time. And if you were there, and if you would look on the eyes of the Pathfinders, seeing that the work of their hands are fruitful, you would certainly see the glow in their eyes, the glow of awe in their faces. Like, it was such a blessing for us adults to see that. We also have a big kite that we shared during the kite day. This is Big Bertha. It's a multifacet box kite that is huge. It's really huge. In reference, this is when we are bringing the Big Bertha to the area where we will fly it. And it took four people to carry it, making sure that we are going through the wind, because otherwise we will be blown with a kite as big as it is. And during lunchtime, Uncle Frank holding the end of the spool, there's two of us launching the Big Bertha, and it just went straight up in the air. This is a picture of Big Bertha, 200 feet above the ground on a 200 feet all out line. And everyone had an opportunity to fly Big Bertha, from the smallest, everyone that went to the field, because some of them are having lunch and decided to be busy with lunch rather than going, and that's okay. But for those who came to the field to fly it, what an awesome experience. Even my wife got to fly it. Pastor Melas was able to fly it. Interestingly, where we are flying it, we introduce the spiritual meaning of flying a kite. And when my wife, Jessica, was flying it, she was so excited and did some gestures, and she lost her eyes on the kite. And then next thing you know, the kite is going down and down and down. And Pastor Melas was spiritual lesson number one. When flying kite, always look at your kite. Same thing with your relationship with Jesus. Always look upon Jesus. The moment you put your eyes away from him, then you're going to be like that kite, going down and down and down. And Uncle Frank took over and grabbed the spool and looked at the kite again and put some pressure on the kite. And the kite started to arise, and flew higher and higher and higher. And Pastor Melas, kite lesson, spiritual lesson number two, pressure. Sometimes the Lord would bring pressures in our lives in order for us to rise higher in our spiritual walk with him. But what a great experience it is for us. This is our club kite. We call it Big Ben. And at the time of this event, it was already raining. And the conference decided to cancel the event altogether. So everyone started packing and getting out of the drizzle. Prior to that, there's some gust of winds that are really good, but there's a little bit of rain as well. So our club decided, okay, we work hard on our kite, let's go ahead and fly her anyway. But because the kite, Big Ben, was really soaked already with rain, while it flew and went up about 100, 150 feet, probably the most, it started to descend. It's because, you know, the gust of wind cannot support the weight of that wet kite. But overall, we had a great family time. Not only that, we were blessed with a number of awards. We are not there for the awards, by the way. We are not there for the awards. But the Lord had just blessed us. Our pastor, Pastor Melas, won as the champion on the pastor event. Praise the Lord. Uncle Frank won as the champion on the staff event. I won as the champion on the theme kite event. Kitty won as the champion on the smallest kite that flies. And by the way, the smallest kite that she flew was only the size of a cell phone. And I wish we have a picture, but I guess I did not capture it, because during that time, yeah, it was raining already. She also won third place for the highest flyer in her category. And also we have Lily, who also won third place on the staff kite competition. So should the event not canceled, Chula Vista would have won as the club with the highest point in Southeastern California Conference Kite Day. But as I mentioned, we are not there for the points, we're not there for the awards, but rather we are there for the learning experience of making kites. Little that the children know that while they indeed make kites, they know how to use scissors now. They know how to put a thread on a needle. They know how to use a sewing machine now. And that is the life's blessing. And of course, in addition to the great spiritual blessing that it was learned being together. So that's our first quarter report. For the next quarter, April 7 will be our bike-a-thon. Now, why are we doing this? Well, we thank you and we praise God for your support. And I believe we have raised more than 3,000 altogether on our car wash. I can't remember the total number, so, give or take. To send 35 people to Gillette, Wyoming for Camporee takes more than just $3,000. We are estimating maybe between $700 to $750 per person. So having said that, we are praying, but at the same time, in God's grace, we are acting on how we could support our Pathfinders to be able to go. We have been telling our Pathfinder family, have faith govern you and direct you to go. Do not allow financial limitations to discourage you from not going. We told them that if it's God's will, then it will be God's bill to begin with. So on April 7 will be our bike-a-thon. You'll be hearing from our Pathfinders. They'll be calling you. They'll be sending you letters. And we appreciate the blessings that you would provide and also the blessings of prayer that you would bring to the Lord on our behalf. And may the Lord bless you and keep you as you also experience worship in today's Pathfinder Day of Worship. Amen.
Thank you so much, Aldie, for that report on everything that's been happening in Pathfinders. Really appreciate that. And I'm glad that the weather cooperated enough that you could, get some of the kite flying done. And it's good to see that you were able to keep up the tradition of success for the Chula Vista Club, because I know they've done very well in the past. And so I want to thank you all again for being here for our Sabbath School this morning. And at this time, I will invite those who will be leading in our Sabbath School lesson discussion to stand, and we'll have our closing prayer. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for blessing our time this morning. Thank you so much for the parents and the Pathfinder leaders that are investing in our young people and leading them to you, to the only way of salvation, Lord. And we thank you for our teachers, those who will be leading out. Give them your Holy Spirit, Lord, and give us all your Holy Spirit, that we might be able to fully understand your word and walk closer with you. And be with those who are on their way here. See them here safely. This is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you all, and enjoy your class today.
What a blessing to see you this morning. It's a beautiful Sabbath. It's going to be a beautiful Pathfinder Day experience for each one of us. And looking forward to hear our Pathfinder do the sermon, their special music, and their participation in worship this morning. We praise God. We thank Him for this privilege for the Pathfinder be entrusted the pulpit. We've been telling our Pathfinders and educating them that that is holy work. To lead in God's worship service is a divine service. And with that, our Pathfinders certainly take that responsibility very, very seriously. Fritz was mentioned during our prayer this morning. I'd like to report that I visited him yesterday in the hospital, and he was in good spirit. There are some more procedures and possibly rehab that will be done for him. But the last I heard towards the afternoon is he's being prepared to be discharged. So Fritz, if you are listening this morning, as I welcome our congregation in this morning's Sabbath School, I trust that you're listening and we welcome your presence the same. Also with those that are attending through live streaming, we welcome you. And may the Holy Spirit guide and bless you the same as we study His words this morning. Let's pray. Father God in heaven, we'd like to worship You. We'd like to thank You for Your goodness, for Your grace. Father, we thank You for Jesus Christ, our Savior. Thank You for His sacrifices on the cross. Father, we thank You as well for the Holy Spirit, our guide, our counselor, the one that inspires us, directs us, sustains us to be Christ-like and to do Your work. Father, I pray for our entire Chula Vista family. I pray, Father, that You will uplift them with their spiritual life. I pray, Father, that You will pour enormous portion of the Holy Spirit upon them. Fill them with the Holy Ghost, dear God, that as they learn that they are justified through the death and resurrection of Jesus, that we may be inspired to live a life that is sanctified in preparation for the coming of our Savior. We also pray for those that are in sickness or in one way or another, in ailment this morning. We think of Fritz, who were rushed to the hospital this week. And I pray, Father, that You will continue to bless him, encourage him, give him strength for quick recovery. And I pray, Father, as well, that You have prepared all of those clinicians that will be helping him, touching him, so that healing may be attained soon. Thank You again for the opportunity and privilege to study Your word. Father, give us wisdom and understanding. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Our topic this morning is longing for God in Zion. So when I think of Zion, immediately what would come to mind is one of my favorite songs, Marching to Zion. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching onward to Zion, that beautiful city of God. And our memory text for this morning is Psalm 84 verse 2, which reads, "My soul longs." How does your soul longs? You desire. You are enthused. "My soul longs, yes, even faints for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God." So before we move forward, let's have first a common understanding of what is Zion. In Hebrew, it was translated from the word Sion or Chion. It is used in parallel of, in synonym of, or could be used in relation of Jerusalem. And it was mentioned in Samuel, 2 Samuel chapter 5. It was referred to as a specific hill, called Mount Zion. And during that time, it is a military fortress. It's a stronghold for the Jebusites that was conquered by King David, Mount Zion. And later on, it was renamed to the city of David. So this morning when we talk about Zion, Jerusalem, city of David, we may be pertaining to or areas or components of the same thing. 1 Kings chapter 8, verse 1. Now Solomon assembled the elders of Israel and all the heads of the tribes, the chief fathers of the children of Israel, to King Solomon in Jerusalem, that they might bring up the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord from the city of David, which is Zion. So this text confirms that when the Bible talks about Zion, city of David, Jerusalem, on the same context, the Bible is talking about the same thing. But notice that bring up the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord. So where is the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord located? It is located in the sanctuary. It is in the most holy place. That section of the tabernacle is where the Ark of the Covenant is located. This is another reference again about Zion in Psalm chapter 78, verses 65 to 69. Then the Lord awoke us from sleep like a mighty man who shouts because of wine, and he beat back his enemies. He put them to a perpetual reproach. Moreover, he rejected the tent of Joseph and did not choose the tribe of Ephraim. Why? Verse 68, but chose the tribe of Judah, Mount Zion, which he loved, and he built his sanctuary like the heights, like the earth which he has established forever. So, Jerusalem, Mount Zion, tabernacle or sanctuary. So that is where the sanctuary was also erected. And that is the dwelling place of God. We studied before the different parts of the sanctuary. We have the courtyard, okay? And then as you enter the holy rooms, we have the holy place, okay? When you enter the holy place, to the right or the north side is the altar of showbread. To the left, okay? Or the south side is the golden candlestick. And as you walk further to the west is the altar of incense. Behind the altar of incense is the curtain, okay, embroidered with cherubims. And behind that is where the Ark of Covenant is situated. The cover of the Ark of Covenant, we learn, is called the mercy seat. And on top of that are two cherubims. And in between those two cherubims is the Shekinah glory of God, where he dwells. The holiest of holy dwells in that tabernacle. And we could certainly reference that in Isaiah chapter 8, verse 18. Here am I, and the children whom the Lord has given me. We are for signs and wonders in Israel, from the Lord of hosts, who dwells in Mount Zion. So again, from the previous information, we know that who dwells in Mount Zion, it's right there, the tabernacle, in the most holy place, on top of the mercy seat. It's so bright that no man could withstand that. So bright. The holiness of God is represented with that bright light that we, as sinful as we are, would mean death if we behold it. More reference, Psalm 74, verse 2. Remember your congregation which you have purchased of old, the tribe of your inheritance which you have redeemed, this Mount Zion where you have dwelt. Another one from Isaiah 24, 23. The moon will be disgraced and the sun ashamed, for the Lord opposed will reign, where? On Mount Zion and in Jerusalem and before his elders gloriously. Gloriously, not only in brightness of his holiness, but omnipotence, power, sovereignty. That's the Lord that we serve. an amazing God that we serve. How can we doubt? How can we not allow God to dwell in our hearts? How can we not align ourselves into the righteousness that Christ already offers to us? I found this in the book, The Ministry of Healing, pages 437 and 438, talking more about the sanctuary. In the sanctuary of the wilderness tabernacle and of the temple, that there were the earthly symbols of God's dwelling place, one apartment was sacred to his presence. What apartment is that? The most holy place. The veil, which I describe and mention, inwrought with cherubim at its entrance, was not to be lifted by any hand save one. To lift that veil and intrude unbidden into the sacred mystery of the most holy place was death. For above the mercy seat dwelt the glory of the holiest, glory upon which no man might look and live, that Shekinah glory of our powerful, ever-living God. On the one day of the year appointed for ministry in the most holy place, what is that one day in the year called? The Day of Atonement, or the cleansing of the sanctuary. The high priest, with trembling, entered God's presence while clouds of incense veiled the glory from his sight. Now let's visualize it. Why would the high priest do that? True. But the act of clouding that holy compartment is basically to diffuse the light, to diffuse the brightness of Shekinah glory coming above the mercy seat. Now keep in mind that before the veil is the altar of incense. And so Bible scholars would comment that the priest, the high priest, will use a censer. And if you visited Messiah's mansion, you would have exactly seen what I was talking about. So the high priest will then bring the censer, load it up with incense from the altar of incense, and as he walks on the holiest of holy compartment, he would bring more of that smoke to diffuse the light that is coming on top of the mercy seat. Throughout the courts of the temple, every sound was hushed. No priest ministered at the altars. The host of worshipers bowed in silent awe, offered their petitions for God's mercy, saying, "The Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him. The Lord reigneth. Let the people tremble. He's seated between the cherubims. Let the earth be moved. The Lord is great in Zion, and he is high above all the people. Let them praise thy great and terrible name, for it is holy." One day, in that sweet by and by, and once we are transformed into his likeness, we will see him face to face and not worry about dying because of the brightness of his glory.
In Greek mean, and not in English. If we read it in English, it says terrible. It's like, whoa, you know? You get scared. But I don't think that's what that terrible is trying to say.
And that's a very good point. The message sometimes is depending on the interpretation of an individual. And there's no such thing as idiosyncrasy in the same manner of interpreting the message. So if the message, for example, a prophet when a prophet will come. It's a good thing, right? It's a good thing. You'll be visited by the prophet because the prophet would carry whose message? God's message. But for those who are unbelievers, for those who are sinners, if you're visited by a prophet, wow, that's terrible. That is terrible. And oftentimes the prophet would leave, leaving the unbeliever, leaving the unrighteous with what? Bad news for them. But if you are aligned with God, with His holiness, that terrible means positive. That terrible means good news. So, reading further, we have the understanding of what Zion is. Zion is God's chosen holy mountain that in the Bible is used in parallel or synonymous with Jerusalem. And because His sanctuary was built there, the holy place that the most holy place that contains the Ark of the Covenant is there, His dwelling place is there, and He reigns there. And because that is the center of God's work for salvation, not only during Israel's time, it's only for also for our time. Joy and hope and overflowing is also originating from Zion. I thought I'll discuss this background to give us an understanding that when we read the different psalms that we're going to be discussing this morning about Zion, we are on the same understanding as to what Zion is and what it's about. Now let's go to Psalm 84. Psalm 84 for our Sunday lesson. A day in your courts is better than a thousand. Turn to your Bible to Psalm 84. Reading from the verse 1 to verse 3. How lovely is your tabernacle, O Lord of hosts. My soul longs, yes, even faints for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God. Even the sparrow has found a home, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may lay her young. Even your altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. You see, the songs of and hymns about Zion magnifies the beauty and sovereignty of the Lord. The tabernacle is a refuge, not only for those believers who are seeking alignment with God in forgiveness of sins, but the tabernacle is a place where God and man can also communicate. Verses 4 to 6. Blessed are those who dwell in your house. They will still be praising you. Blessed is the man whose strength is in you, whose heart is set on pilgrimage. As they pass through the valley of Baca, they make it a spring. The rain also covers it with pools. So what is the valley of Baca? During my study this past week, it referenced to spiritual meaning of the valley of weeping, the valley of difficulty, the valley of tears. So the psalm is saying that even though you pass through the valley of difficulty, the valley of weeping, they make it a spring. What is a spring? A source of life. So if we are in God, we could be victorious, that even we are in certain difficulty in this life, we could trust that the Lord is our refuge. He will provide and He will take care of us. Verse 7, they go from strength to strength. Each one appears before God in Zion. O Lord God of hosts, hear my prayer. Give ear, O God of Jacob. Verse 9 now. O God, behold our shield and look upon the face of your anointed. For a day in your courts is better than a thousand. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of the wickedness. For the Lord God is a sun and a shield. The Lord will give grace and glory. No good thing will be withheld from those who walk uprightly. O Lord of hosts, blessed is the man who trusts in you. So we are in pilgrimage. We are. And we're looking forward to that day when we will be marching to that Zion, to that gates of that new Jerusalem that will come from heaven. I cannot think of a good parallel, but a Pathfinder experience. For three North American Division Campery now, we have been traveling from here to Oshkosh, Wisconsin by train. And to get there is about 52 hours. So we traveled from San Diego to Los Angeles. We changed train from Los Angeles to Chicago. And we changed train again from Chicago to Milwaukee. And then we take a bus from Milwaukee to Oshkosh, Wisconsin to meet 65,000 Pathfinders from all over the world. 52 hours. Traveling with kids ages 10 to 17 years old. And yet, just like the Israelites who are very eager to get to Zion, what really surprised me during this travel is no one have said, Uncle Aldie, are we there yet? Not a single kid had done that. They're so excited that they're going to be meeting that temporary city of North American Division Campery. They're so excited that they will see thousands and thousands of Pathfinders in uniform, the same, almost the same, as the one that Dr. Rogers and I are wearing this morning, from different languages of the world, different type of march from different parts of the world. They're so excited. They're longing to see that. And I can tell you, 52 hours on the train, but for them, it was so much fun. It was so much fun. And it gives them an opportunity not only to spend time together, but also to minister to others. Right in the plains of New Mexico to Colorado, there are a lot of Boy Scouts that will go in and out the train. So they would get on board, and after a couple of cities, they will disembark for their hiking. And in the train is a car with glass windows, and the top is also glass where you could view the terrain, the mountainside, the plains, and that will be the place where our Pathfinders would mostly stay. And when Boy Scout would come, that is also an opportunity for them to share what they believe, to interface with fellow youth. And as we are talking about Zion and our experience here as a church, we should pattern our relationship in the same manner. While we are waiting for that new Jerusalem, while we are waiting for Christ to come, we in prayer should also be in a relationship that is encouraging, that is kind, that is loving towards our fellow church members. That way we could experience the beauty of Zion while we are still here on earth. Because that's what will encourage us for the coming and waiting for that great day of Jesus' coming. That is what will be encouraging us. Because see, if we are not praying for one another, if we're not encouraging one another, if we're not uplifting one another, then we will not experience Christ in church. And it's not going to be Zion for us here in Chula Vista. Perhaps it will be Babylon or Egypt, perhaps. Amen? Amen. Let's go to Psalm 63. Psalm 63, verse 2. Psalm 63, verse 2. Let me read from verse 1 just to get the full context. O God, you are my God. Early will I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh longs for you in a dry and thirsty land where there is no water. So I have looked for you in the sanctuary to see your power and your glory. Because your loving kindness is better than life, my lips shall praise you. Thus I will bless you while I live. I will lift up my hands in your name. My soul shall be satisfied with marrow and fatness, and my mouth shall praise you with joyful lips. So, again, we should desire to seek the Lord. And if that is our desire, the rest will just follow. The rest will just follow. Now, Psalm 15, verses 1 and 2. Psalm 15, verses 1 and 2. And if you have it, don't hesitate to raise your hand and join us in reading it, okay? Psalm 15, verse 1 and 2. Brother Carlos has it. And if one could go to Revelation 21, 3, which we will be reading after. Psalm 15, 1 and 2.
Lord, who may abide in your tabernacle, who may dwell in your holy hill, he who walks uprightly and works righteousness and speaks the truth in his heart.
So, who are your neighbor in Chula Vista Church? They are the saints, right? And so, therefore, when we come to worship God in here, when we mingle with fellow believers, we trust that it is a safe place. Amen? Because we know that God's saints are in here. They are the ones who walk uprightly. They are the one who are righteous, and they are the one who speaks the truth in their heart. Revelation 21:3. Revelation 21:3. If you have it, raise your hand. Thank you, Brother Greg.
Revelation 21:3, it says, "And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God." Amen.
And that is our ultimate goal, for us to live face to face with God. Desire of Ages, page 26. You see, we have work to do. Sister White says, the work of redemption will soon be complete. In the place where sin abounded, God's grace much more abounds. The earth itself, the very field that Satan claims as his, is to be not only ransomed but exalted. Our little world under the curse of sin, the one dark blot in his glorious creation, will be honored above all other worlds in the universe of God. Here, where the Son of God tabernacled in humanity, where the King of Glory lived and suffered and died, here, when he shall make all things new, the tabernacle of God shall be with men. And as read, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. And through endless ages, as the redeemed walk in the light of the Lord, they will praise him for his unspeakable gift, Emmanuel, Jesus Christ, God with us. I don't know about you, but it kind of makes my hair rise. In longingness, in excitement. And I pray and trust that that is your heart's desire the same. But again, we could experience a piece of heaven here if we walk in the likeness of Christ, all of us. We may be able to experience that while waiting for the new Jerusalem. Let's go to Monday's lesson now. Psalm 122 is the foundation of our lesson, entitled, Pray for the Peace of Jerusalem. Why do we have to pray for the peace of Jerusalem? Reading from verse 1, I was glad when they said to me, Let us go into the house of the Lord. Our feet have been standing within your gates, O Jerusalem. Jerusalem is built as a city that is compact together, where the tribes go up, the tribes of the Lord, to the testimony of Israel, to give thanks to the name of the Lord. For the thrones are set there for judgment, the thrones of the hands of the house of David. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May they prosper who love you. Peace within your walls. Prosperity within your palaces. For the sake of my brethren and companions, I will now say, Peace be with you. Because of the Lord, because of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek your good. So the psalmist is saying, because God dwells in Jerusalem, I will pray that God's goodness be poured upon that city. In a similar manner, we need to pray for one another. As we experience the goodness of God, it is important that we encourage, lift up one another, that may be able to withstand the temptations. It's great to be busy providing testimony and ministering to our brothers and sisters, right? It gives us great experience, great interaction, great participation. Especially here in Chula Vista, we do have a lot of ministries that you could participate and could enhance your spiritual experience. Our personal ministries of the church is very active. At least once or twice per month, we go door to door in our neighborhood, distributing our printed materials. Speaking about printed materials, we do have glow tracks and books that is available to you so that you could witness and experience the divine service we could do for the Lord. Children's ministries, pathfinders, adventurers, there are some departments of the church that you could certainly participate to further enhance your spiritual experience. Now, why do we have to do that? Let's go to John chapter 13. Yes, sir. Yes.
It's not referring to Jerusalem, Jerusalem, right? Is it referring to those who believe in God, God's people, known as the... Because now, we don't have to be born in Israel to be an Israelite.
Correct.
If we believe in Jesus, and we study his word because we know in his word, that's the right path to follow.
Yes.
Right?
Exactly.
So, I also know that in Scripture, it says those that were born in Israel are not all Israelites. He says their true Israel is in the one that is responding from the heart to Jesus Christ and his word. That now those believers who are guided by the Spirit, they are the new Israel.
Yes.
It's not those that are born in Israel.
That is correct.
So when it says pray for Jerusalem, I just want to make sure that, because I know there's a lot of brothers and sisters who say, well, we got to pray for Jerusalem. We got to pray for Israel. They probably have a misconception of what Scripture is talking about. Because I know, we all know that in Israel and Jerusalem, they're the ones who crucified our Lord. They wouldn't accept it. I'm talking about the religious leaders and the system back then, not all the people. And then again, they were all there saying, crucified him, you know. But what I'm saying is, we don't pray for Jerusalem, Jerusalem, or, you know, in Israel.
across the sea somewhere.
So when he says pray for Jerusalem, he must be talking to those who really believe in God and those who really seek him and try to follow him, right?
And that is an excellent clarification. Excellent clarification. You know, we are these spiritual Israelites. And when the psalmist says here, pray for Jerusalem, it is not only the Jerusalem then, but now. So, and we as spiritual Israelites, we are of different level in terms of our spiritual experience. Some of us are truly Adventist. Others are Sadventist. Others are Badventist. Where others are Gladventist. But regardless of the type of spiritual Israel you are, when we pray collectively for one another. In fact, verse 9 of Psalm 122 clarifies that. It says, because of the house of the Lord, or let me go ahead and read from verse 8 to get in full context, or verse 6. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May they prosper who love you. Peace be within your walls, prosperity within your palaces. For the sake of my brethren and companions, I will now say, peace be with you. And listen to this. Because of the house of the Lord, our God, I will seek your good. So the psalmist is not praying for Jerusalem, not because of who is in Jerusalem, but because God dwells in Jerusalem. The psalmist is praying for Jerusalem because God dwells there. And because God dwells there, he intends that God may show his goodness, his mercy, and love, not only for the Israelites, but for everyone that is in there. Last couple of lessons, we discussed that when we pray and we mingle and engage with our brothers and sisters, we'll not only affirm those that are doing well, but we certainly pray for those that are causing negative things in relationship with one to another. Rather than dwelling on them, we pray for them. We have one hand in the back, and then Uncle Rick here in the back. Thank you, Brother Mark.
Thank you. Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
Thank you for that rendition of the passage. In addition, we got to recognize and bear in mind, even for our lives, that the Holy Spirit, who is God, knows from the beginning to the end. His oration, his words that he gave through spiritual enlightenment to David, he chose words that will live through time till the end. So these words, they were spoken in one era of time, but they're also applicable in this era and onward because it's the perfect God who penned it.
Yes. And we have Uncle Rick here with a comment as well. Thank you so much, brother, for sharing your thoughts.
Was there another hand? Yeah. I read also in the Bible that says God does not dwell in the place that is made with men. And it says also that God's throne is in heaven above all. So how can we say that he's in Jerusalem?
Dr. Dan?
There were five physical tabernacles or sanctuaries talked about, one of them which wasn't built. But in all of the other four, God's presence was there. The last one was destroyed in AD 70. During Christ's lifetime, he transferred the significance of the dwelling place of God from the physical sanctuary in Jerusalem to himself. He said, destroy this temple, in 3 days I'll raise it up again. He was talking about his physical body, not not the temple that was there in Jerusalem. And so that transference from the physical to the spiritual took place during Christ's lifetime. And then since then, the indwelling of the Holy Spirit in each one of us makes us living sanctuaries Amen. For the Lord. And when the New Jerusalem comes down, we won't need a physical temple there to worship in, because Revelation tells us that God Almighty and the Lamb are the temple thereof. Mm. And so the significance of spiritual temple will continue throughout eternity. And so when we pray for Jerusalem, we're praying for the presence of God. And that's the spiritual Israel. We're not Israelites per se, because we're not born in Israel. We're not Jews per se, most of us. But we are spiritual Jews, because we're following what Christ told us, and we are part of spiritual Israel or spiritual Jerusalem.
Right, and we certainly have a discussion on that as well on our Tuesday lesson, just to bridge our discussion. Zion, the home of all nations. Zion, the home of all nations. Turn to Psalm 87. And this would certainly bring more light to what we are discussing. Reading from verse 1. His foundation is in the holy mountains. What foundation is being mentioned by the psalmist here? God's holiness. God's holiness. The process of salvation is in the tabernacle, which is in the holy mountain, Mount Zion, in Jerusalem. The Lord loves the gates of Zion more than all the dwellings of Jacob. Glorious things are spoken of you, O city of God. I will make mention of Rahab and Babylon to those who know me. Behold, O Philistia and Tyre with Ethiopia, this one was born there, born in Zion. And Zion, it will be said, this one and that one were born in her. And the Most High himself shall establish her. The Lord will record when he registered the people, this one was born there. Both the singers and the players on instruments say, all my springs are in you. Now, why is it important for the psalmist to recognize, oh, that was born there, he was born there, she is born there? Let's look at Nehemiah. Nehemiah chapter 7, verse 5. Nehemiah 7, 5. And this is about registration for census during the time of Israelites. It says, then my God put it into my heart to gather the nobles, the rulers and the people, that they might be registered by genealogy. And I found a register of the genealogy of those who had come up in the first return and found written in it. Now let's parallel that registration in the book of Luke, mark Psalm 87 at the moment, and go to the book of Luke, chapter 2, verses 1 to 3. It reads, and it came to pass in those days that the decree went out from Caesar Augustus that the world should be registered. This census first took place while Quirinius was governing Syria. So all went to be registered, everyone to his own city. Now going back to Psalm 87, when the psalmist says, the Lord will record when he registers the people. Now, why is registration to Zion mentioned as an important thing in here? You see, even with our own current generation, your place of origin is important. You know, when you know or met somebody, oh, where are you from? Oh, I'm from La Jolla Cove. See, we associate location and place of origin with ethnicity, economic status, social status. So when I met somebody and say, oh, I'm from La Jolla Cove, what will come to mind is, oh, this guy may be rich. because the houses there are, you know, expensive. Or when someone says, oh, I'm from the vineyards of Bakersfield, oh, then probably this is a farmer, right? So during those time, when you're born to Zion, it's a big thing because, oh, wow, you were born in the holy, in the place where the holy mount of God is located. And yet, what the lesson is saying that, hey, the spiritual Zion residents, spiritual Israelites, were offered to everyone. In fact, let's go ahead and read Romans now. Romans chapter 3, verse 19 to 26. Romans chapter 3, 19 to 26. Okay? If you have it, please raise your hand. Thank you, sister.
You're welcome. 19 through 26. Now we know that what things soever the law saith, it saith to them who are under the law, that every mouth may be stopped, and all the world may become guilty before God. Therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in his sight. For by the law is the knowledge of sin. But now the righteousness of God without the law is manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ, unto all and upon all them that believe. For there is no difference, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God, to declare, I say at this time, his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of him which believeth in Jesus.
So what it's saying is, Zion, the home of all nations, I mean, to be able to be a resident of Zion, it's not just exclusive for Jerusalem, but rather for everyone who accepted Jesus Christ. We are the spiritual Israel. And turning to Romans chapter 10, verses 11 through 13, here's what it says. Romans 10, 11 through 13. For the scripture says, whoever believes on him will not be put to shame, for there is no distinction between Jew and Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich to all who call upon him. For whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Shall be saved. Zion, it's for all nations. This Day with God, page 218. Just referencing to this passage, the constant burden of our hearts should be, what can I do to save souls for whom Christ died? Knowing that Zion is open to everybody, right? All around me are precious souls lying in wickedness that must perish unless someone shall work for their salvation. How can I best reach these wandering ones that I may bring them to the glorious city of God and present them before the throne, saying, here am I and the children whom the Lord had given me. Christ has appointed to every man his work. His faithful servants will not lose their reward. They will gain eternal life, and the well-done, good, and faithful servant will fall as sweet as music on our ears, on their ears. We certainly have work to do. While Zion is now open to every nation who accepted and believe in Jesus Christ, we are messengers. We are messengers. And we must not only minister to them, but we need to testify and witness to them the Christ-likeness character we do have. And I pray that God will equip you. I pray that God will empower you. I pray that God would fill you with the Holy Ghost to be able to fulfill this divine service for God's cause. In the interest of time, let me jump to Wednesday lesson now, Psalm 46. Wednesday lesson, Psalm 46, Safety and Peace of Zion. Beautiful passage, 11 verses. Who has it? Can somebody read it, please? Psalm 46. We have one in the back, Brother Mark. Thank you. Psalm 46.
God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, even though the earth be removed and though the mountains be carried to the midst of the sea, though its waters roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with its swelling thereof. Selah. 1, 2, 3?
Read all verses.
Okay. There is a river whose streams shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacle of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God shall help her just at the break of dawn. The nations raged, the kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice and the earth melted. The Lord is hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Come behold the works of the Lord, who has made desolations in the earth. He makes wars cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and cuts the spear in two. He burns the chariots in the fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge.
Amen. So while the Lord is the perfect refuge and the source of Zion's lasting peace and security, he is our refuge as well in our time today. In Matthew chapter 8, verses 23 to 27, you know this story very well. The Lord with his disciples is on the boat, and the sea was uncalm, and great tempest arose on the sea, and so the boat was covered with waves, and Christ was sleeping. On verse 25, it reads of Matthew chapter 8, verse 25, then his disciples came to him and awoke him, saying, Lord, save us, we are perishing. But he said to them, why are you fearful, O little faith? Then he rose and he rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was a great calm. So the men marveled, saying, who can this be that even the winds and the sea obey him? Okay. Christ is our refuge. Christ is our protection. Christ is our safety. Desire of Ages, page 363. If today we would take time to go to Jesus and tell him our needs, we should not be disappointed. He would be at our right hand to help us. We need more simplicity, more trust and confidence in our Savior. In all who are under the training of God is to be revealed a life that is not in harmony with the world, its customs and its practices. And everyone needs to have a personal experience in obtaining a knowledge of the will of God. It's really important for us, the experience and knowledge of the will of God. We must individually hear him speaking to our heart. On the same page, when every other voice is hushed and in the quietness we wait before him, the silence of the soul makes more distinct the voice of God. He bids us, be still and know that I am God. Psalm 46:10. Here alone can true rest be found, and this is the effectual preparation for all who labor for God amid the hurrying throng and the strain of life's intense activities. The soul that is thus refreshed will be surrounded with an atmosphere of light and peace. The life will breathe out fragrance and will reveal a divine power that will reach men's hearts. Most of the time, our experience, especially when we are challenged, when we are tempted, when we have hardship, is to execute the principle, me, myself, and I. Me, myself, and I. You know, instead of going off our bed in the morning with our knees first, we kind of rush running to do our chores for the day. And yet the spirit of prophecy is telling us, amid the hurrying throng and the strain of our activities, we certainly need to seek Jesus and experience his atmosphere for light and peace. Because if we do, then we are immovable like Mount Zion, Psalm 125. This is the foundation of the Thursday lesson. And just quickly reading the summary from our lesson on this day. Those who trust in the Lord are compared to Mount Zion, the symbol of steadfastness and strength. The magnificent view of the mountain surrounding the city of Jerusalem inspired the psalmist to acknowledge the certainty of divine protection. You'd like to be immovable? Then build your foundation in the rock of our salvation, correct? Don't build it right on the sand. I just love this passage from Steps to Christ. Our growth in grace, our joy, our usefulness, all depend upon our union with Christ. It is by communion with him daily, hourly, by abiding in him, that we are to grow in grace. He is not only the author, but the finisher of our faith. It is Christ first and last and always. He is to be with us, not only at the beginning and the end of our course, but at every step of the way. And we all have challenges. Just one more passage from Mrs. White, Reflecting Christ, page 103. We can keep the law only through making the righteousness of Christ our own, Christ says. Without me, ye can do nothing. When we receive the heavenly gift, the righteousness of Christ, we shall find that divine grace has been provided for us and that human resources are powerless. Jesus gives us the Holy Spirit in large measure for great emergencies, to help our infirmities, to give us strong consolation, to illuminate our minds and purify and ennoble our hearts. Christ becomes unto us wisdom, righteousness, sanctification, and redemption. Longing for Zion. I hope that's what's in your heart today. I hope that's what's in your heart tomorrow. So in closing, let me just summarize our lesson. Zion is a symbol of God's presence, the place where the Lord is interceding for and protecting his people. As the Israelites in the past, we should keep in our hearts a burning desire to be in the presence of God the Almighty. Symbolizing our spiritual relationship, we could be in Zion right now spiritually, symbolically. And then lastly, let us claim Jesus' victory as our righteousness and abide in him every moment of our lives until the very end. Amen? I praise God for your participation. We are on the 11th lesson, two more, and we will be ending our quarter. But I praise the Lord bless you with this wisdom and understanding. Let us pray. Father God in heaven, we long for your soon return. Thank you so much, Lord, for our study. As we long for Zion, I pray that you will strengthen us. I pray that you will encourage us and empower us. I pray that you will fill us with your Holy Ghost, that we may be able to walk in the likeness of Jesus' character until the very end. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless.